Coming up, an introduction to sailing, next on Central Florida on the Water. Central Florida on the Water. This is your host, Lou McNally, and our topic for this episode is an introduction to sailing and sailboats. We're going to cover some of the basics of sailing, talk about what kind of sailboats are popular here, and discuss the resources for learning how to sail. Now, joining us on the program is Captain DJ from USail in Sanford, Florida. Thank you for being here, Captain.
I'm happy to be here.
Good to see you. And we also have Miss Kayla Hines with us. She is a current student of Captain DJ's who's learning to sail. Welcome to you, Kayla.
Thank you for inviting me.
Good to have you here. We're going to be speaking to you in a little while about what it's like to actually learn how to sail. But first to the teacher. DJ, Captain, can you tell us a little bit about how you got involved in sailing in the first place?
Actually, I've always been fascinated with the water. And even from making little boats to float down the creek on the farm to learning to sail back when I was in college, was invited to go sailing, and I was immediately hooked.
Is that how you got started, was in college?
Really? Mm-hmm.
My goodness. Now, which kind of boat did you get started with? I got to ask, was it an Olympic-class boat?
No, it was actually a cruising boat. It was a O'Day 22, a day sailor.
Mm-hmm.
Would just go out and sail around on Lake Ray Hubbard in Texas just for the fun of it.
See a picture of your first outing with the wind?
Mm-hmm.
There you go. And you've come quite a long ways since then. How tough is it, or was it for you, to learn how to sail?
Actually, I'm a self-taught sailor.
So am I.
So I didn't have someone that told me 30-plus years ago, hey, take lessons. It'll make your life at least easier. You wouldn't be nicknamed Crash for about 5 years. So I just essentially went sailing with friends, and I just kept watching and watching and watching, and I would try things, and I've got loads of stories about how I didn't exactly do the right thing.
Right. You've had to right a boat a couple of times that may have gone over.
Yep, exactly. But after about 15 years, I decided that I wanted to do something I like for a living, and I decided that I was going to teach sailing.
I love it.
And then I really started to learn how to sail.
I'll bet you did if you had to teach it. Is that what got USail started?
Yes. I actually was an instructor for another sailing school that I actually helped start.
Mm-hmm.
And Tropical Storm Faye put them out of business, and that left me unemployed.
Mm-hmm.
And so I decided...
Hurricanes can do that.
Yeah. I decided to give it a try for a year, and that was 8 years ago.
And this is where you're located now. It's right down next to the marina there on Lake Monroe, right?
Yes.
Downtown Sanford. All right. So people can go there and they can get lessons from you. And how long does it take for somebody to learn how to sail?
I teach the basic course in 3 8-hour days. And that'll give you the knowledge that you need to sail up to a 26-foot boat in moderate to light winds on inland waters.
26 feet sounds like a big boat.
If
you can teach somebody how to do that
like
in 3 days?
Yes.
Wow. Here's an example right there. There's a couple of your students, I guess, explaining this graphic on there. So you have part of the time in the class teaching the basics. How much of the time is in the class and how much is out on the water?
Usually it averages out about an hour of classroom time in every four-hour segment. So you got an hour in class just kind of reviewing topics and saying what we're going to do on the water, and then we go sailing.
Then we come
in for lunch, and then we do it again.
Now, I'm sure that people, have been watching the show here, Power Boaters, and they know about bow and stern and port and starboard and the motor. And that's pretty much what you need to know. There's a couple of different terms that we need to talk about in terms of sailing, though, right?
Yes.
What would be some of those?
Well, our primary source of sail power are the sails, not okay. the motor. I mean, I sail several boats that don't have a motor at all. Mm-hmm. And if you want to leave the marina, you're going to sail out and you're going to sail back in.
That's right.
So it's knowing, the most important thing about sailing is knowing where the wind's coming from.
Uh-huh. So
and how it affects
plays
you.
A role.
Big role.
Yeah, knowing which way it's going to blow.
Yes.
And whether it's going to get stronger or weaker and more dangerous or not, too.
But. Which sails you want to have on the boat, because dependent the boat I teach on, I actually have it intentionally rigged so that when people learn to sail, it's like when you learn to drive a stick shift.
Right.
Not an automatic.
Right.
So they actually have to understand the weather, which sail to put on the boat, and choose the set of sails
for the
weather.
Let's say 23-foot boats or something like that. Mm-hmm. We see diagrams of them. I think we got one coming up here pretty shortly, mm-hmm. which will have, there you go, which has two sails on it,
yes.
a mainsail and a foresail. How many different sails would you also have in addition to those?
Well, on the on that particular graphic, it's just showing a jib.
Which is the foresail.
Yes.
Right? The small
the sail
one in the front.
In the front. Yep. And on my particular boat, I actually have four different sails that go on the front of the boat.
That would be for different wind conditions?
Yes, like the storm jib is the smallest one, and then what I call my working jib is what the one I use most often when I'm teaching the class. And then the Genoa is a really big sail you use for when the wind's less than 10. And then if you're just going directly downwind, you can fly the spinnaker, which is a whole other...
which is the big, huge...
Yes, the balloon-like sail when you're going downwind.
So there's different names for the points of the sail, the clew mm-hmm. and the tack and the leech mm-hmm. and the luff and things like that. Mm-hmm. These are terms that people need to know.
Yes.
If they're going to be going out sailing. What about the different types of sailboats? Can you explain those to us?
Depending on the type of sailing you're going to do, whether you're going to be racing or cruising or just day sail... whether you're going to be sailing by yourself or sailing with a bunch of people, there's a number of different types of boats. In Florida, we have shallow waters. So boats that have retractable keels is real good. I teach on, because it's the most common, I teach on the sloop rig.
The sloop is the one you most often see, right?
Yes. One mast, two sails.
Yeah. Cutter has two foresails. I mm-hmm. see that. Yawl and ketch just depend on where the mizzen mast is, that smaller
exactly.
mast in the back of the
whether
boat.
Whether it's before or behind.
But even with
the
sloop,
steering.
You're operating two sails at once, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what do you have to know to be able to do that?
Well, typically the sail you pay most attention to is the one closer to the wind.
Meaning?
So when you're going upwind, all the activity is going to be focused around the head sail or the sail in the front of the boat.
I got you.
And if you're going downwind and doing a lot of turning, which is called jibing, then all the focus is going to be on that mainsail, so you don't hurt anybody with the boom as it comes across the boat.
Okay. Now, some of these boats, particularly around here in Central Florida, we have dagger boards or center boards, and
mm-hmm.
some of them have big keels.
Mm-hmm.
What's the difference?
As far as where you want to sail, and the type of sailing that you're going to do. I mean, if you're going to do a lot of racing, a lot of people want a fixed keel because it does a lot of better performance.
That's basically a big chunk of mm-hmm. lead or something underneath the boat that tries to keep it stable against the
yes.
wind.
Yes. It's the because sailboats are just like an airplane, except we're on our side.
On the side, that's right.
Sails are one wing, the keel is the other wing.
Yeah, they act
and
just like wings, too.
Yes, they do.
Propel you forward. Sure.
Yes. So the, but... Here in Florida, the shoal draft, the boat that I actually teach on is a shoal draft keel with a centerboard.
That means you can go into shallower water, the shoal
yes.
water. Yeah.
I can go into 2 feet of water if I want to.
Holy mackerel.
So I've sailed all in and out of the Everglades, and that came in real handy.
I would never have thought of sailing in the Everglades.
That's one of my favorite adventures that I went on was sailing up the Shark River and down the Harney.
No.
In and around the Everglades.
And that's with a boat that doesn't get any deeper than 2 feet.
Well, the rivers are a little bit deeper. I mean, we got stuck once and had to hop out and redirect the boat back to try to get out of one of the rivers.
So when we're talking about sailing in different directions, people pretty much think, okay, the wind's blowing that way, so I'm going to sail that way. That's what the old square riggers used to do. But now mm-hmm. we have options, right?
Yeah, because the first sailors, like the Vikings, the Caribbean, the pirates of the Caribbean, the Egyptians. I mean, they only knew how to sail downwind, the wind push them.
That's where the term fair wind came from. It was a fair wind. It's the wind direction I want to go in.
Yeah. But now with what we call the Bernoulli principle, which Daniel Bernoulli in the mid-1700s figured out what makes birds fly, which is what makes airplanes stay up in the air.
Right.
So we can use this same principle to actually pull us through the water. So when we're going towards the wind, except in that what we call our no-sail zone.
Right, which is right straight at it.
Yeah. Right. Then we can't.
Oh, yeah, here's the example right there. We have the boat on top can't really go anywhere because the wind's blowing right straight down the length of the boat. But in all those other directions, the beam reach, the broad reach, the close hauled, the running downwind, any one of those directions you can sail quite comfortably from that one wind direction.
Yes.
What if you did want to get right straight back, in this case, towards the north? How would you sail?
You'd have to sail what we call close-hauled course with your sails hauled in tight, as close to the wind as you can get. Mm-hmm. You sail that way for a while, and then you have to turn 90 degrees
to that
through the wind, up through the wind.
You got to put the sails on the other side of the boat.
And then you sail up for a while until you decide it's time to go back that way. So essentially, you zigzag your way upwind.
That's called tacking, right?
Yes.
And, you know, I mean, we've seen that in the America's Cup. Those big, huge boats, they still have to tack if they're going to go upwind. So basically, if you want to sail anywhere, you can.
Yes.
You don't have to worry about, I can't go there today because the wind's blowing from that direction.
As long as you have enough water to get there,
you can
go there.
Now, there's something else that folks might not realize is that you can't stop a sailboat.
That is correct. We don't have brakes. We have a heavy keel, typically on most of the boats that I'm on are displacement boats. And so once something's in motion, it stays in motion. So even though you let your sails go, which we call luffing when they're just sitting there wiggling back and forth, the boat still has momentum.
Right.
Exactly. And you actually need to understand and use that to your advantage, the glide zone. So when I dock under sail, I have to make sure I luff my sails at a point to where I just glide in and have the boat come to a stop there at the
top. Gotcha. All right, so let's get down to it. Somebody is watching and they're interested. They maybe didn't want to think about a motorboat first. They wanted to think about a sailboat. How would they get started?
Well, there's a couple of different options that they have. I mean, I've known a number of people buy their own boat and teach themselves to sail. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm in that category there, self-taught.
Sure.
But I do wish someone would have told me to go take lessons. I actually teach the American Sailing Association curriculum, which was started a little over 30 years ago, to actually share my passion for sailing with other people. So whether you want to live on the boat or you want to race, just learning the basics so you can sail confidently and safely.
Mm-hmm.
And not hurt yourself or anyone else.
Okay,
so whether you take lessons.
Yeah, that's taking some lessons, basically, isn't it? Yeah. Was it one or two lessons or something like that?
I actually teach the basic course, which is the ASA 101, the basic sailing course, in 3 8-hour days.
In 3 8-hour days. Now, let's get Kayla involved here. Kayla, you're a student now of Captain DJ's. And why did you even start?
Well, I've been using motorboats and stuff my whole life. And
so you like being on the water?
Yes, I love being on the water. And sailing seemed like a very challenging hobby to take up. A lot of new skills that I didn't know, a lot of new terms, tying knots, reading the weather. Seemed very challenging, but rewarding at the same time.
Okay, well, I got a couple of questions to ask you about that when we get back. But we had a chance to join Captain DJ and Kayla for her first introduction to sailing. Let's take a look.
So what we're going to do is we're actually going to motor out into the lake. We always have to turn into the wind to put the sail up. Okay. So you just want to throw that off of there when I ask you to cast it off, okay? Now, since we're in the marina, we always want to don't go racing out. You are responsible for the damage of your own wake. But when you leave the dock and you keep control of the bow, then you've got the boat. So I'm giving it just enough throttle so that I can control the bow of the boat. Okay. Now, see how the engines turn like that? That's causing the boat to turn that way. When I'm in a confined area, I like to use the engine and the tiller that's fastened to the rudder to make the boat turn like a sports car. Okay. So if I do both, then I turn very quickly. But you never want to do, let's see if I can make myself, you never want to do that because you don't know what's going to happen. Now you want to raise the handle on the black and white line, the main halyard. Yep. And then I'm going to do my thing back here by releasing the main sheet. And then go ahead and hoist the mainsail. So you want to pull hard and fast as you can till the sail goes all the way up. There you go. Excellent. Yep. Little wind shift there. Yep. Keep pulling. Little tug. Okay. Get rid of all that line at your feet. Okay. I'm releasing the boom topping lift. Now I need you to cleat the boom vane. The one down on the underneath the boom. You're going to pull straight down as hard as you can. Excellent. That's good right there. Okay, now go ahead and set on the windward side here. Now I'm going to get the motor out of the water. I just did. So if I am not steering the boat right now with just the one sail up, what do you think the boat's going to do?
Start, keep turning.
Which way?
That way.
Okay. So let me take that off. So nobody's steering the boat right now. So look at the front of the boat. It's turning into the wind.
Mm-hmm.
Right. That's called having weather helm.
Captain DJ, tell us a bit about what you're actually explaining to Kayla here.
When we first go out, the first time out and get the mainsail up, I let them experience what we call weather helm.
Okay, the feel.
The feel of the tiller and how the boat actually pivots around the keel and to realize that we're really dependent upon the sail.
Right, yeah.
And the wind. To keep us going, so we have to properly adjust the sails. And I did a little smoke and mirror sort of thing there where I took the tiller extension.
I saw that, yeah, and then saw the bow go right under.
And I intentionally, when I was raising the motor, I actually was making the boat sail itself, knowing that I had weather helm.
Which means that you had some purchase with the wind, basically.
Yes. Yeah. So I... And then I explained to her, if no one's steering the boat, what does the boat do? Because most people think the wind's going to blow it.
Right.
And it's not. It's going to pivot around the keel.
Pivot around, exactly.
So that's really an aha moment for a lot of people.
Did you have that aha moment, Kayla?
Yes, I did.
You did?
Yes, I did.
So this was your first lesson?
Yes.
And, well, how did you feel by the end of the day?
It was great. I'm definitely hooked. We had a lot of great wind that day, so we were able to do a lot of tacking. The boat was really heeling or leaning over a lot. It was really fun.
That's something that a lot of folks that I know have trouble with, the fact that when you're really cruising in a sailboat, you're actually like this most of the time. But it's fun. It's fun, and it certainly can be. Now, just about anybody can do this. There's no question. I mean, you see people tailing these huge winches and big, huge sails, but it's not a matter of upper body strength or anything, is it, really?
No.
I mean, anybody can do it.
Yep. Most of my students, I tell them if they can move from one chair to the other and they're smarter than a rope, they can learn to sail.
Wow. That makes it sound pretty interesting. I think I'd like to try, too. No, but I already do. So you've had one lesson now out of how many are you going to have?
I've had two now.
You've had two?
Yes.
So let me ask you, you were already experienced as a boater and happy being on the water. What did you see as the biggest difference?
definitely reading the wind and understanding how the sails work and kind of getting used to the fact that you really can't control the winds. You have to make the boat kind of adhere to whatever the wind's doing, rather than if you have a motor, you can just kind of go wherever you want,
You don't really pay as much attention,
yes,
even that, or to the weather.
Yes.
What's your advice to somebody who might be considering it?
I would say definitely it's helpful if you take lessons or a class, or at the very least study the concepts. There's a lot of different languages and nautical terms involved in sailing, a lot of learning the different parts of the boat, a lot of learning different knots,
mm-hmm,
and again, reading the wind and just kind of understanding when the wind does this, I need to do this. And
it's a heck of a tradition, though,
yes,
I mean, to be part of, absolutely. One quick question for you, Captain.
Mm-hmm.
How would somebody get involved if they didn't want to necessarily take a lesson first?
Well, I offer, if they just want to try it, I offer introduction to sailing, which is just a 2-hour. You can go along for the ride, or you can actively participate. That's pretty customized to each person. They can also find their local, and Florida has sailing clubs on every little lake, both coast, all over the place. You can just find, Google the local sailing
yep,
community. And a lot of times people who for some reason single hand a lot are always looking for a crew, and sometimes they're willing to teach somebody that's willing to learn just to have reliable crew.
Wow. Now we'll talk a bit more about how people can get in touch with your outfit in just a minute. But first of all, we're going to toss to our tip of the week. And this time it's about a device that can help you out if you run into problems or fall overboard out in the open water.
Hi, I'm Michael McNicholas with the U.S. Coast Guard Auxiliary. I'm the Division Staff Officer for Public Education, and I'm here today to talk to you about a device that could potentially save your life and get rescuers to you quickly if you ever get into a distress situation. What I have is an emergency position indicating radio beacon called an EPIRB. This device emits a signal to rescue satellites, and there are two major types. The first type is the one that I have in my hand, which is a standard EPIRB. This one normally stays with the vessel, and you could tie it off to the vessel if you need to, because we always recommend you stay with the vessel. The other one's a personal locator beacon, which normally goes on your life jacket, and you could have one for everyone on, or just, you know, for one in the group. And there's two different types. The first type is standard. It just uses the search and rescue satellite constellation. The other one uses GPS to pinpoint your accuracy a little bit better.
And our coasties tell us that those EPIRBs are getting a whole lot less expensive than they used to be. So they're actually something that you could actually have on your boat as well. Now, for sailboats, when it's not in the open water, say in the St. John's River or the Intracoastal Waterway, we have a couple things to deal with, like very tall masts and very low bridges. How do we deal with that, Captain?
We have a couple of options. There's sound signals that you can use, and there's proper ones just for requesting a bridge opening, or you can use your VHF and hail the bridges on either 9 or 13, whichever one is posted for that particular bridge.
We were asking the Coast Guardsmen a couple of weeks ago on the show why they needed a whistle or they needed an air horn. This is one of the reasons. They can actually signal the bridge?
A prolonged blast and a short blast will tell the bridge tender you would like the bridge open.
Now, those bridges will open on command or on demand or whatever. What happens if it's rush hour?
Well, a lot of times...
For the cars, that is.
Yes. Could be for the boats. A lot of times, certain bridges, because of traffic, will only open either on the hour or at a certain schedule.
Mm-hmm.
And essentially, you have to just either plan your trip around that opening or just hang back and wait for that time to come for
We've
the bridge to
We've seen that happen
open.
Even on the Halifax here. There's mm-hmm. one bridge where we'll see five or six boats waiting
mm-hmm.
for that bridge to open.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sure that does happen. So let's talk briefly about the rules of the road for sailboats. Now, we know we covered powerboats, and we know about the red right return and where mm-hmm. to actually drive your boat down the channel and things like that. What happens if a powerboat meets a sailboat? What happens at that point?
Generally speaking, the sailboat has right-of-way because they are less maneuverable. It
okay.
becomes right away is all about maneuverability.
All right. So this is something power boaters need to know.
Yes.
If they're headed out there.
There are six exceptions.
There are exceptions to that, which
mm-hmm.
are?
As far as commercial traffic, or if someone loses their steering cable and they can't control their power boat, a sailboat has to get out of the way of
that.
A boat not under command.
And you tell them that over the radio or?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
There's also signals you can display as
mm-hmm.
well. But, you know, constrained by draft, restricted ability to maneuver, commercial fishermen don't have right of way over sailboats. Sailboat must give way to them.
They must give way, huh?
Yes, for commercial fishermen, not Joe Blow with a fishing pole, but commercial fishermen.
So this is another reason that taking a course and learning all those specific requirements is very important to you.
And then the two that most people don't get is overtaking is a big one, and then a narrow channel is another one, another exception.
Lots of things to learn, But you're the place to go do it, absolutely.
Yes.
Well, we're going to find out how to get in touch with you. We're coming close to the end of the program here, and we want to thank Captain DJ and Kayla Hines for joining us. Captain DJ, what is the best way for people to get in touch with you?
Well, the website is the letter U, sail.com.
Okay, no dash or anything, just USail.
Nope, USail.com. Okay. And then also we have a Facebook page, and you can just Google us, and we're out on the web and get our phone number. You could text, email, call, any of those ways you can get a hold of us.
That sounds great. Folks out there, if you have a question or a comment, please email us at wdsc@daytonastate.edu, or you can go to our Facebook page. Now, to check out our schedule, visit our webpage at wdsctv.org, and you can find other episodes of this series and other local programs online in the WDSC YouTube channel. We'll see you next time. Get out there and try sailing.